Hallelujah. We just ask you to stand on your feet and let us open our service. This is a very wonderful day. As you know, we came to celebrate the life of our friend. We just want to adore God, to worship Him, give Him all the praise. I just want to take a moment, lift up your hands, and have a word of prayer. I wanted to pray. Pray for the friend. Pray for the wife. Pray for the children. Pray for the brothers and sisters. Let us just in the moment of prayer, let us pray for them. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you for this wonderful time. We thank you for this moment. Father, we come here as your children. We come here, Lord, to say that we are together with the family of the late. Father, I pray that you strengthen them. I pray for the wife, I pray for the children, I pray for the sisters and all their relatives. But Lord, you bind their hearts. Bring healing in that brokenness. Father, we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's give God a hand.
Somebody projected for us the book of Luke chapter 16
from verse 19. I went through this paper here and I just shook my head. I realized there are people who do things. Turn to your neighbor, tell your neighbor, what have you done? That when people think of you, they are reminded of what you have done. What have you done? We are going to go in the book of Luke chapter 16 from verse 19. The Bible says there was a certain rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen and fed. English, you help me, I'm from East Africa. So whatever, you know, every day. Go down, supposedly you find it. But there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, full of sores, who was laid at his gate, desiring to be fed the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. So it was that beggar, it was that the beggar died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And being in torment in heads, he lifted up his voice and saw Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. Then he cried out and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger into water and cool my tongue. One day I was preaching in Busia in the eastern part of Kenya, and then one young man came to me when I was preaching the crusade in the marketplace. Then the young man told me, George, what you are talking about, you don't know. You know me, I'm very smart. On that day when God is judging people, I'm going to stand in the line behind. When I move next to him, while he's dealing with this one, I would jump inside and enter heaven. No way. I said, oh, that's your program. That's my program. After a few years, I heard the young man has died. So I went to the funeral. He was laying in the house. Then what he told me, I remembered. I said, now, where's the jumping? You said you dodge. So people thought I went to attend the funeral, but I wanted to prove whether he had jumped. So when I arrived in the funeral, I saw the body. I said, now, you say you will jump, now you see. In my heart, I said, see now, young man. Jesus Christ said, I am the way, the life, and the truth. No one can come to my Father except by me. Every human being in this world was created for a specific lifetime. And some of them were created to live 10 years. Lifetime of 10 years. Others were created to live a lifetime of 20 years. Others were created to live a lifetime of 60 years. Others were created to live a lifetime of 70 years. Others were created to live a lifetime of 90 years. Others were created to live a lifetime of 100 something years. Now, here comes my question. What have you done with your lifetime? There are two words here, life and time. Life is given by God. Time is what we live within. He says, in your lifetime, when God gave you life, what did you use with that life in your time? Because everybody was born for a particular time. Take a friend, you are born for a particular time. I slap him till wake up. Tell him, you were born for a particular time. In your lifetime, whom have you impacted? In your lifetime, whom have you changed? In your lifetime, what have you left for your children, 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 children? pamphlet here, I saw what this wonderful man did. He has impacted the world globally. He has been fighting against poverty in African nations, lobbying and talking to the presidents so that they can help the economic empowerment of Africa. When I went through all this here, I came to realize this man has contributed towards the building of libraries in different cities of Kenya. He imparted people with knowledge. His idea was, if somebody can have knowledge, he can live his own destiny. So he invested much in education. The greatest investment you can ever give to a person is knowledge, education. Tell your friend, give me education. Touch your neighbor, say, neighbor, you can take your man and give me education. In your lifetime, time is very short. Time is very short. Don't waste time. If you can do anything, do it now before it is too late for you. This man knew how to use his time amicably. He used his time right. He did all he can do. When he was alive, he wrote the books. When he was alive, he could write episodes in magazines, writing stuff, putting up libraries, helping governments, talking to the leaders, raising money, helping the poor. He did all he can do in his lifetime.
We can sit here and mourn, we can sit and cry, we can sit and count the losses. But as I was seated there, I was thinking, see it as an opportunity for us who are alive to get that word, to listen to that word. He's gone, but he's still sending that message. He's not with us like right here. Hey, but we're gathered. We traveled. We stopped our businesses. You know, we're not just here to give. Yes, we will. But you know what? I took some message home. The lifetime message. And the message of dying empty. We saw that message with Miles Monroe, we read it, but the message came and went. And here comes again, we are reminded of the same message. And you know what, some of these messages, they get deeper when they hit very close to home. Some of us, when we were growing up, and I had a passion for economics, and most of the students, especially Kenyans, we go out there and we start looking for these great economists. And then we're like, here, let's look back home. And maybe people who are in their 20s and 30s who love economics and who love public policy, they can relate very well with Professor. He did not just initiate one of the best public policies in Kenya at the University of Connecticut. Most of the people who have followed, they know his work. As a fellow, I mean, we all know this stuff. But yes, we can read this beautiful story. We can look at his wonderful, beautiful picture. We can look at the sister and the nieces and the cousins and, you know, all this great family. But you know what? I also count it as a positive thing to me tonight that I took some message home. That I was reminded right here that heaven is real. That I was reminded right here, what am I going to do about my name? Thank you. We want to take this opportunity and really tell the family that we're with you. We believe and, you know, we are praying for you. We are supporting you. And there are other people out there. The memorial that they did down in D.C. You know, whatever is happening at home, whatever is happening in the backyards, in people's bedroom when they are praying for you guys, there's so much that is going on. But we celebrate a life. It is very painful, and I think this is a pill that is going around. I mean, we've done enough, especially in the Kenyan community. We've really lost some of our very best young men and women. Our kid, you know, the PhD student from New York, you know? We know the parents, we know the families, they're our neighbors. It's painful. The gruesome, the very bad road accident that happened in the South Shore in Boston. It's painful.
Praise God again.
Amen.
We have a song. confused in memory of Professor Kimani.
Thank you. ya my brother niruo onani akwina ke arainaga agethie woko ni kwa arainaga woko ni ararene te muno 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 na niruo raino memory service is si yothe ni tondu aharu ikirite thimu ini o hatu sote o agethie wira rucini agathie akinaga weboru ni tondu ni aramwirirwo ni mwathani nginya rugendo rwake rurakinya muico na nikio turarwikira hau roinwo kundu guothe ni tondu
Professor Theology, early years and family. Professor Samson Mwangi Kimenyi was born in Gedumu location, Kandara Division of Murang'a County on December 12, 1956. His parents were Mwalimu Francis Kimenyi, Elizabeth, and Elizabeth Jerry Kimenyi. As the ninth child in a family of 10 children, he grew up in Geshagini Village, Murang'a County. Education. Mwangi attended Gedumu Primary School from 1963 to 1970. As a young boy, his father recognized his mastery of numbers and talents, communicating with words. His father often relied on Mwangi to act as a secretary and treasurer to keep his accounts when he met with his community members. In 1971, Mwangi entered Kaisajiro High School, and after passing his O levels, he entered Gedumu High School for his A levels and finished in 1976. He next attended the University of Nairobi, where he graduated with a bachelor's degree in chemistry with honors. Mwangi taught us at several high schools and later worked with the Kenya Post and Telecommunications Corporation as he prepared to move to the United States to attend Ohio University. He completed his graduate studies at Ohio in 1982, earning a master's degree in economics and a master's degree in international affairs. Mwangi continued his graduate studies at John Mason University in Virginia, where he obtained a doctorate in economics in 1986. He also studied for a certificate program at Harvard and University of Michigan. He was visiting scholar in 1990 at the University of Wisconsin at Max, He was a visiting scholar in 1990 at the University of Wisconsin at Madison and at the Center for the Study of Public Choice, John Mason University, in 1996. In 1997, Mwangi attended the Hoover Institution, Stanford University, and in 2000, the Kennedy School of Government at Harvard. Family life. Mwangi was married to Irene Wangoi Kimenyi, who he met, or both were students at George Mason University. They have three children, Francis Kimenyi, Bidian Kimenyi, Kimani Kimenyi, and Robert Boro Kimenyi. Work. After completing his studies at George Mason University, Mwangi joined the University of Mississippi in 1986 to 1991. As an assistant professor. His exemplary work was recognized with an award by the Senate and the House of Representatives for the state of Mississippi for work on public transit. Mwangi was a prolific researcher, and much of his work focused on institutions and economic development, Africa's political economy and policies for economic growth and poverty reduction. He co-authored and edited 8 books, 6 policy monographs, and published widely in refereed journals. Mwangi's most recent publication, co-authored with a colleague, Governing the Nile River Basin, The Search for a New Legal Regime, was published in 2015, Brookings Institution, Washington, D.C. He received many honors and awards for his speech, including the George Skowronski Prize in Economics, excuse me, in 1991. He won for the Outstanding Research Award in 2001 by Global Development Network, GDN, and the Global Peace Scholarship Award by Global Peace Foundation, 2015. In 1991, he was named by the Policy Review, Washington, D.C., among the top 10 young economists in the United States. At the University of Mississippi in 1989, he was honored with the Outstanding Faculty Award by the School of Business Administration. He was in Who is Who among American teachers nominated by the students in the National Dean's List. Excuse me. During his tenure at the University of Connecticut, Mwangi continued to establish himself as an exceptional researcher whilst participating in numerous worldwide international economic and education policies forums, often as a keynote speaker. In 2008, he keynoted the World Bank Economist Meeting Africa Division. He was also involved in the supervision of doctoral and master's candidates and was one of the resource persons for AERC doctoral program. He was also an external examiner for various African institutes, including the Department of Economics at the University of Nairobi, the University of Botswana, as well as the University of Zimbabwe. Mwangi cared deeply about issues of economic development, poverty reduction, and good governance. During his tenure as a founding executive director of the Kenya Institute of Public Policy, Research and Analysis, KIPRA, the organization was ranked the top policy institution in Africa and was recognized as an international center for excellence under his direction. He was an influential advocate for building strong institutions to support economic growth in Africa. He championed strong U.S.-Africa relations, adopted of policies that alleviate poverty, led to better income distribution, and encouraged private sector development in Africa. During his tenure at the Brookings Institution, Mwangi led the African Growth Initiative, AGI, and established relationships with six African think tanks. He had a keen sense of issues plaguing the African continent, and as a result, he developed ADA annual publication Foresight, which highlighted emerging critical issues in the region. In 2012, he initiated monthly meetings at the United Nations Congress to discuss pertinent issues of African development, African Dialogue at the Hill. That was the name of it. In 2012, he was invited by the United States Senate to testify at a hearing on promoting U.S. exports to Africa by Senate Committee on Foreign Relations. In the same year, he spearheaded discussion on the extension of Africa growth opportunity. So he did a lot with NGO here. Community development. Mwangi was committed to education and health issues in Africa. He founded Hekima Community Library at Dakaine, Moranga County in 2004, and he donated the library for community use. This library is one of the best equipped rural community libraries in Africa and serves thousands of rural people in Kenya. Mwangi also insisted in the establishment of many public libraries in Kenya, and together with African Christian Church and schools, he helped organize medical camps in various parts of Africa. He was one of the founding members of American Friends of Kenya. He served as a board member in various public institutions, including Moranga Teachers Union, Gedumu High School, and Kiagare Secondary School. Illness. Mwangi fell ill in March 2014, and he went to be with the Lord. On June 6, 2015, at John Hopkins Hospital in Baltimore, he was surrounded by his wife and children. Precious is the sight of the Lord. is the death of his saints, Psalms. Comes from the book of Psalms. Thank you.